Arjun Kapoor, who is a math lover and a social observer who challenges how we interpret data in a world overflowing with statistics. He's a published mathematician and is part of the National eSafety Youth Council. I'd now like to call upon Arjun Kapoor, who'd be talking about lies, damn lies, and statistics. Lies, damn lies, and statistics. Arjun Kapoor, over to you.
Around that same time, mathematicians like Leibniz, Fermat, and Descartes are transforming mathematics into a precision tool for physics, engineering, and astronomy. The mathematical revolution is in full swing. And yet statistics? It barely exists. For centuries, humanity could calculate the trajectory of a comet more accurately than it could estimate a birth rate. We could model gravity, but not mortality. We could model the temperature of a coffee as it cooled before we could estimate how much of it an average person would drink. Why? Because uncertainty is unintuitive. Because statistics is unintuitive. Calculus asks, what is the rate of change? Whereas statistics asks, how do we reason when we don't know the rate? That is a much messier question. And certainly it is a question that requires us to let go of that certainty we crave so much from maths, and to think in possibilities, to accept that the same information can tell different stories depending on how we slice it. And that is just the world we live in today, one where the biggest challenges from climate change to public health to AI all hinge on our ability to make decisions under and about uncertainty, to make decisions on information that we do not yet know. So that's why today I want to help you look at statistics not as a set of scary formulae or graph, but rather as a powerful and necessary way of thinking. So my name is Arjun, and these are the lies, damn lies, and the statistics that govern our very lives. So, So, just how unintuitive can it really be? Imagine you're back in COVID, it's the second wave. Every morning we wake up to a new press conference and some new news headlines. This morning's headline reads, 1% of us now have COVID. Will we ever get out of the second wave? I don't know how. They always manage to make the headlines more doomier and gloomier than the last. But this one looks a bit better. There's a bit of chatter and a bit of buzz. It's all this talk about PCR tests and RAT tests and how accurate they are, and how they might be our ticket to getting out of lockdown. And much to the dismay of the media, because no one ever reported this, the accuracy they all kept asking about wasn't just one number, it was two. There was sensitivity, which is how accurate a test is at telling you you have the disease. And then there was specificity, which is how accurate the test is at telling you you don't have the disease. In other words, your probability of testing negative given you do not have it. Now, you're reading the news or you're watching it and you're sitting there and you're like, maybe I have COVID. And so what you do is you break out a COVID test, a RAT test to be specific, and you follow the motions, you give yourself a swab, you let it sit there, you maybe even give it a bit of a shake. And then you wait. It's the longest 15 minutes of your entire lockdown, but that's okay, because you're in lockdown. You have plenty of time. And you test positive. So, given this information, that the COVID test has a sensitivity of 80% and a specificity of 98%, what do you think the chances are that you actually have COVID if you test positive? Do I hear takers for A? No? Okay. What about B? C? Okay. What about D? Okay, more people. Well, if you had your hand up for D, congratulations, you are correct. The real number is actually much, much lower. It's like less than 50%. And I know what you're thinking. The lowest accuracy of our test was 80%. How did we get here? Thankfully, math works out really easily with pitches. So let's imagine 1,000 people, and we assume all of them get tested. If, as claimed, 1% have COVID, then that means 10 do have COVID and 990 do not. Now, assuming everyone gets tested, the 10 people that do have COVID, the 80% sensitivity means that 8 out of 10 will correctly test positive. Then, a 98% specificity means that roughly 2%, or about 20 out of 990, will incorrectly test positive. So, all things considered, if you tested positive, you have no way of knowing if you're part of those 8 or those 20, which means your odds work out to about 29%. That's much lower than the 80% we were expecting, or some of us. And out of all the places where the math works out to be unintuitive, statistics is probably one of the last places you'd want it to be unintuitive. Because, after all, literal lives are at stake here. Though, I doubt math would care, sadly. And that's not just the only thing. There are a sea of pitfalls, right from the start of the statistical process all the way to the very end. And even interpretive fallacies that can occur after it too. One of the most common statistical pitfalls is known as selection bias. It happens right at the start, and it is essentially when our method of sampling or collecting data negatively impacts our results or skews them in some way. A really easy way to remember it is simply to remember this graphic. Imagine you're trying to answer the question, how many people like filling out surveys? If you answer that question with a survey, the results are going to look something like this. That's not because 99.8% of people actually like filling them out. It's because the people who would have otherwise said no simply threw it in the bin. So they're not there to balance it out. Now, you might look at this graphic and go, that's so obvious. How do people fall for this? Oh, it's happened. Not just people, but governments. For instance, a few years ago, the Australian government rolled out a healthy heart screening program. The idea was simple. Offer and promote free heart health checks to all Australians with no strings attached. The goal? Catch heart disease early on so we could save lives and ease the burden on our healthcare system. Now, at first, the results were dramatic. Of the people that showed up, rates of high blood pressure, high cholesterol, and other major risk factors were dangerously high. Now, there was panic, not just among people, but also among the media. Headlines started flying around claiming that over a third of us had major heart risks and major health symptoms. But that wasn't true, because think about the people that didn't show up to the survey. They were often the young people of Australia. They were often the people simply too busy to get a heart health check. They were the people that had no reason to worry about their heart. And so just like that, surveys that would have otherwise gone on to inform policy decisions at the highest levels of government in Australia were now nothing but meaningless numbers. And so selection bias crept in to the data. But let's say you get past that. Let's say you've sampled correctly, and now you're on to analyzing your graph. Imagine you come across a graph that looks like this. What is your first instinct? Is it perhaps that ice cream causes drowning? Is it perhaps that ice cream predicts drowning a month in advance? Because the astute among you may have seen it's about a month behind. Like, we knew sugar was bad for you, but was it really this bad? Like, I've had a lot of ice cream and I haven't drowned yet. I'm sure you've had a lot of ice cream and you haven't drowned yet either. So what's really going on here? In this case, there is a logical explanation. It's the summertime. You see, May, June, and July are like the summer months of Spain, which means that when it's summer, it's hot. You go outside for a swim, because you certainly don't swim when it's cold. And when you swim, you're sadly more likely to drown. On a happier note though, when it's summer, you go out and you get ice cream, because you want to cool down, it's a hot day. I'm sure Aussies do that all the time. And so that's why both of these happen to peak in the summer. But there isn't always a logical explanation. Take, for instance, this graph here. The price of gold in London and the Google searches for how to cut your own hair. Now, funnily enough, this graph has a higher correlation than this graph. But we know from common sense that there's nothing going on here. It's just a coincidence. Like, if gold prices were really impacted by Google searches, I would be telling all of you right now to start Googling. But we know they aren't. And a really easy way to identify is just to look at the axes. Like, 2004 to 2012 should ring red flags for cherry picking. But how did we know that this makes sense and this doesn't, or it's just chance. It's common sense. Common sense is the most important weapon we have at identifying misinformation and combating statistical misconceptions. It is only through common sense that we can say, yes, this makes sense, and no, this doesn't make sense. And that is why I would go so far as to say, common sense is the single most important weapon we have at identifying statistical misinformation. And if you're wondering, these graphs are also where that age-old adage comes from, that correlation does not imply causation. Just because two lines look the same doesn't mean one must cause the other. But let's say you've gone past analyzing your data. You're now on to publishing your results. There are still ways to go wrong, and there are still ways to mislead others. Because here's the truth. The data does not speak for itself. It whispers, and it changes its tune depending on who is listening and what they know. One of the biggest interpretive fallacies happens right at the end, after you've published your results, with misleading graphs. Take, for instance, this graph here. This is a breakdown of hospitalizations for COVID-19 for over 60s, but based off of vaccination cohort. So the way you would read this graph is you would go, 1.5% of all the people that meet those conditions who were hospitalized for COVID were hospitalized for COVID. They had one vaccination dose. Now, from the outset, it looks like having one vaccination dose is the safest bet because they were only 1.5% of the hospitalized. But here's where that common sense comes into play again. The vaccines were designed specifically so that you don't get severe symptoms, so that you didn't have to go to the hospital. Doesn't this graph contradict that? It makes it look like having vaccinations puts you more at risk. And so, what's happening here? Here is the exact same data set, but with one tiny adjustment. Here, it's been adjusted by the size of the vaccination cohort. So the way you would interpret this graph is you would go, out of everyone that meets those conditions that has zero vaccination doses, out of that entire group, 15.1% of them who had zero vaccination doses were hospitalized for COVID. Effectively, this tells you your chance of getting hospitalized for COVID up until July 2022. And so here, having one vaccination dose does not look so safe anymore, does it? So what was happening? Well, firstly, I'm not saying that you should or you shouldn't get vaccinated. I should preface this by saying that's probably a conversation between you and your doctor. But what I am saying is, if you had three or more doses, your chance of getting hospitalized was roughly 4.5 times lower than someone who was unvaccinated. So this tells us something else, because around this time, about 3% had zero or one doses. So this should tell us that roughly 13.5% of all hospitalizations came from only 3% of people. They were overrepresented by a factor of 4. So this should tell us that the reason so few unvaccinated people were hospitalized were because there were so few of us to begin with. If anything, this should seem rife for misinformation. In fact, throughout COVID, graphs like these were floating around everywhere as anti-vaccination rhetoric. And many people sadly made health decisions based off of this information. Sadly. But let's say you make it past this. What is the point? What is the point of me coming up here and telling you about all these pitfalls and traps and fallacies if I can't help you avoid them? So to do that, I want to arm you with 3 very special questions to combat any form of statistical misinformation. But before I do that, I want you to cast your mind back to a humble tomato soup with a not-so-tasty vegetable in the middle. I know it's almost dinner, and I know we're all hungry, but just bear with me for a minute. So, the first question I want you to ask, whenever you see a statistic, is 1, how was the data collected? If the data was collected in a way that is prone to bias, you are probably going to see biased results. And as a result, you might make biased interpretations. Trying to read and interpret biased data is like trying to assess the quality of the entire soup by only having a single leaf from the middle. Yes, you are technically having the soup because you're having a part of it, but you're not really getting the whole picture. There's a whole lot more that you're missing. In the same way, you need to make sure that the data you use or the data you read is sampled fairly. So you can think things like news polls on particular ideological issues. Maybe the viewers of a particular news channel lean one way or another. Think surveys, national surveys on particular state matters. Maybe the rest of the country sees differently to the home state. Secondly, I want you to ask yourself, what is the context? Without context, we are blind. Trying to interpret data without context is like trying to have soup without a spoon or a bowl. You don't do it because it gets messy. You don't do it because it doesn't work. And so you shouldn't do the same with data either. So when you see a statistic, think, is this right? Is this what we expected? If not, try and think of why. Maybe it truly is something we didn't expect to see. And lastly, I want you to ask yourself if the data has been pooled or combined in any way. Because data that has been pooled or combined can often contradict ungrouped or uncombined data. So think every university major, or every state, or every anything. In general, the word every should serve as a red flag. Because trying to interpret pooled or combined data is like trying to assess the quality of two different soups after having mixed them together and then tasting the mixed product. You don't do it because it doesn't make sense. So you shouldn't do it with your data either. And if you do see the word every, that's not to say that the data should be counted out. It means that you should investigate further. So the next time you're out there and you're reading or watching the news, or you might even be scrolling past it, ask yourself these three questions, and maybe, just maybe, you might find yourself reading a lie, a damn lie, or a statistic that aims to mislead us through our very lives. Thank you.